Good morning.
You know, I had a gift this morning that was somewhat unexpected. Yesterday, I received a text message from the guy who was the pastor of the college ministry that Bethany and I were a part of when we met. And he and his wife that I'd never met were actually visiting her daughters over near Lima, Ohio, and they stopped in to visit us in the first gathering today. And so it was awesome. And this is kind of cool. This is why I share this. They thought you guys were awesome. So, you know, whether that's exactly true or not, you did a good job of fooling them, or you're awesome. I mean, it's one or the other, right? So they just said, man, we walked in and we were just greeted by so many people and everyone was friendly. And so thank you. Thank you for being awesome. As we jump in to this third week of our money series called Economic Atheist, I want to say right out of the gate, last week, with the message about the fence of favor, like the idea when we live inside the fences, the rules that God gives us, we have his favor and blessing, and we live outside those fences, we're sort of on our own a little bit more. I wanted to make one more comment about that I just think is appropriate, because a lot of times what we want, what we're looking for is, Rob, just give me the rules, right? Just tell me what I'm supposed to do. And as long as I do that, as long as I follow the rules, then, you know, God shows up and everything works out. And I just want to say that theological idea that treats God as though he's a genie, and if we just get the rules right, if we just rub the lamp, then all of a sudden, poof, God comes out, right? I think we have an image about that, right? I completely reject that. What we need is not more rules. What we need is a deeper relationship with God, right? And so it's, again, it's not about figuring all that out. It's about what's going on in our hearts. And so, you know, we shouldn't think, well, what exactly am I supposed to do? And I'll just do that. We should talk to God. We should have a relationship with him, and that should change who we are at a deep and a meaningful heart level. So I want to encourage you guys again, you know, in week three of this four-week series, even though this is typically, you know, a difficult topic, something people are like, oh man, are we talking about that, you know, in church? I want you to plan to enjoy this. Have you guys been enjoying this series? Has it been fun? We're going to have fun today, okay? I promise you, we're going to have fun today. We're going to learn from this. So I want you to learn today. And we're going to be transformed by this as well. So forget the guilt and pressure that typically comes along with this topic. This is not at all about that. I just want to continue this journey in a way that transforms us and has the potential to really transform the world in which we live. And so, Father, today, we want to give you our minds. We want to give you our hearts. And I just pray, God, that you would meet with us, that you would speak to us. God, that you would change us. And that as we leave this place a little later today, that we wouldn't be the same people that we were coming in. Make us different, and God, use us to make the world in which we live different as well. We ask these things together in Jesus' name. Amen. So today, what I want to do very simply is answer the question, why I tithe? This isn't necessarily why you should tithe. You can make that decision for yourself. I just want to give you this from more of a personal perspective. And so I'm going to give you some broad ideas. And then I'm going to give you four specific reasons why this is something that I do that I think will be helpful, at least for your consideration, and certainly they're going to be biblical. Now, before you jump in and go, well, that's an easy answer. Why does Rob tithe? Duh, he's a pastor, right? It's like, sucka, don't you have to, right? Like, you'll get in trouble if you don't, right? Or you might get fired or whatever, right? Is that how that works? Where it's like, you have to because of your job, but I don't, right? Sometimes we think that. So before I give you my answer and answers to the question, I want you to hear the answer to that question from someone else, from someone who's gone on the journey toward generosity. We typically don't talk about tithing here. We talk about being generous, right? Who's gone on that journey and has seen it make a powerful difference. So let's listen to another New Hoper answer the question why he tithes. Check this out.
Because, number one, God tells us to. That's part of being a Christian, is, you know, giving back to God. You know, everything that we have is His, so, and He only asks for 10% of it back, so, you know, so that's, you know, we feel that's what being a Christian is. And when we started coming to New Hope, we were given $5 a week for an offering, and then we thought, yeah, that's kind of skimpy, so we upped it to 25, and then we upped it to 50, and then there was a series on tithing, and one of our congregation members was up on stage giving a testimony on how that they decided to tithe and how God has blessed them after doing that. And Jeanette and I talked about it, and you know, we're only doing 50 a week, and we figured out how much the tithe was, and that was going to be a major stretch. But we decided that if we're going to be Christians, we need to tithe, and we'll have to figure out some other things to do. But we put it in our budget, and it's been there ever since. At the beginning, it was hard, yeah. But once we started tithing, blessings flowed, and the budget got easier because we kept working the financial peace plan, and we knocked our debt down. And once we knocked the debt down, there was a lot of money that we didn't realize we actually had. Paid down debt, which included paying off our house. We worked that down for a better part of 4 years. We really concentrated on paying the house off. We finally got there. For a while there, the only thing we had was one car payment. And Jeanette and I were starting to think about plans for retirement, what we would want to do, where we'd want to go, you know, whatever. Of course, that's all changed now, but I still feel necessary to keep up the tithe that we had. Lost 2/3 of our income, Jeanette's income, and then I lost my job. I still have Jeanette's retirement, which is what I'm living on. But, you know, that's a big chunk that I have lost since Jeanette's passing. There's been quite a difference. But, you know, giving to the church is what I feel I need to do. That goes along with what I learned in Financial Peace University, is after you become financially free, you know, your generosity quotient just goes through the roof. And so, you know, I've made a point of trying to be overly generous and helping people out. Oh, it's mind-blowing, you know. There's been several instances when I've been able to be generous to people in the church or outside the church. And every time I do, you know, it just gives me goosebumps. And so I look for opportunities to be generous.
Wow, right? Isn't that incredible? And I love, you know, you could see the other questions. He was kind of thinking for a minute, but the question, what is it like to be a generous person? It was instant, right? It's mind-blowing. And the thing that Jeremy and I didn't even know when we talked to Todd weeks ago about doing this, and when we showed up and he started to tell the story, and he said, you know, hey, so his wife suddenly passed away. He lost his job, and yet he continues to give at the same level that he gave at before all that stuff. And it's like, well, what's the difference? And he goes, well, really, my tithe would be a third of what I give. Like, I'm like, why in the world do you do that, right? And it's just, it was so powerful. So some general thoughts about why this is something I do. And here's the thing. Every church on the planet has some kind of ongoing conversation about generosity, about giving, about tithing. Like I told you already, the last time we had a whole series where we talked about this was 6 years ago now. But the first one is it's fundamental, right? It's this foundational thing. Sometimes we think that tithing or giving at that level is some advanced thing. Like if I'm climbing a ladder at some point when I'm really high and scared and tippy, like that's when I get to that level. Biblically speaking, the tithe is the first rung on the ladder. Like if you want to know what's the minimum idea that God sort of asks or expects, that's step one. That's not like high up. So it's this foundational thing. Number two is it's mathematical, right? It's this idea of a tenth. Now, for you and I, we might think, well, gosh, man, a tenth of what comes into my household is a significant thing in terms of what I need and rely on to live. But when you think about it, when you think of the work of God's kingdom, if we all just contribute a tenth, it takes a lot of people, right, to accomplish what God wants to accomplish. And then when you add in that the typical Christian actually gives about 3% averaged out, it takes a lot more people, right? It's this mathematical thing. It's also pastoral. And here's what I mean by that. I'm not so sure that someone could actually call themselves a pastor if they never talk about this topic, as difficult as it may be, because the Bible talks about this topic more than anything, with the exception of the kingdom of God. It's something, and I think I told you this last week, I think the reason is because God knows, and the scripture even says, that where our treasure is, there our heart will be also. And so how we think about and handle money is really a big deal. It's like the joke, right, of the plane that crashes and there's two people and they're stranded on this desert island and one of them's like writing help and big rocks on the beach and like setting up a fire, a signal fire to like, you know, ask for help, and the other person's just lounging around. And then the other person says, what are you doing? Like, help me, get us rescued. And the other person says, oh, no, we're going to get rescued. It's like, well, what do you mean? Like, how are we going to get rescued? And the person said, well, I have a job and I make a ton of money and I tithe. In fact, I give $100,000 a week. My pastor is going to find me. Right? So, some of you are like, if I were to be stranded on a desert island, would Rob even be looking? No, of course I would, right? It's also personal. It's personal. And here's what I mean by that. Over the last almost 9 years now, occasionally I get someone asking me a question like this: Rob, are you planning to be here for a long time? Now, some of you are like, haha, you're trapped now that you did that house thing, right? But you know, I always think that's a strange question, because everywhere I've ever gone, I've always thought, I'm going to spend the rest of my life here. Like, I've never gone somewhere thinking I'll be there for a little while, then I'll leave. And so as I think about that kind of thing, what it's tied to more than anything else is that I want to make the biggest possible difference that I can with my life. And I think that we as a church have almost limitless potential. So when we talk about things like generosity, do you see how when we are generous, our ability to make a difference increases? And how when we're stingy, our ability to make a difference decreases, right? And so when we talk about things like being generous and giving, it has nothing to do with the budget. It has nothing to do with my salary. And it has everything to do with us changing the world together for Jesus, right? That's what it's about. I'm excited that Bud and Bethany are excited. Thank you, guys. That's helpful. Tom Rainer wrote a book called I Am a Church Member. And I want to read you just a few quotes from it. The first one is this. Do you know how to remain a member of a country club? Pay your dues. Do that, and there will be people available to serve you. Here's the next quote. Do you know how to remain a biblical member of the church? Give abundantly and serve without hesitation. Different, right? And then here's the last one, and this is my favorite. The concept of an inactive church member is an oxymoron. Biblically, no such church member really exists, right? There's no such thing as an inactive church member. Church is not a spectator sport. Now, I know some of you are like, Rob, that illustration breaks down when you're standing on stage and we're all sitting here watching you, right? Like, so maybe you should say it differently. But it's not, we got it, we're in this together. And so I'm going to say this a number of times today. This is really the point I want to drive home over and over again, because I believe it's one of the foundational reasons that so many people struggle with the idea of tithing. So I'm going to say it this first time, and then the three or four other times we say it and it goes up on the screen, can we say it together? Right? And I want us to say it with some enthusiasm, because the first gathering, the first time they did it, was kind of lame. So I just want to lay the challenge out. Let's beat the first gathering. Amen? All right, so I'm going to do it the first time, and then when it comes up in the future, we'll do it together. So here we go. More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. And to help us sort of get a grasp of that, I want you to check this out. Ouch, right? Ouch. Here's the thing. God brought the pie. He always brings the pie. Here's the part that sometimes we confuse. There's no other pie. It's not like God, the pie that God brought, then there's the pie we bring, right? Well, I work and I do this, and so that's my pie, right? And that one, no. There's only one pie. And God's the one who always brings the pie. It's God's pie. And if we truly believed this, it would solve our ownership problem, wouldn't it? If we really believed that it was God's pie to begin with, which would in turn make it easier to rectify our faithfulness problem. So let me tell you, give you my four answers as to why I tithe. Not necessarily why you should or need to, but why I do. So here's number one. I tithe because I am an economic theist. The past 2 weeks we've said that an economic atheist is one who rejects this idea that there's a God who's over my life, over my finances, and has anything to say about how I should and am supposed to handle my money. I actually believe that there is a God who is over every area of my life, including my finances, and he instructs me as to how those are best used. I believe that. And even in how I said that, there's a problem, right? Because I said over my finances like they were mine, right? Because we got an ownership problem. So let's see what the Bible says about this. So here's where we're going to start. Leviticus 23:10. Here's what the Bible says. Give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you enter the land I am giving you, and you harvest its first crops, bring the priest a bundle of grain from the first cutting of your grain harvest. So here, God is giving his people an instruction even before they've entered the promised land. And you would think that what he's about to tell them would be easier after they inherit the promised land, right? After they actually reside in this land that God is giving them, that the scriptures describe as a place that's flowing with milk and honey, right? So God gives us instructions to his people of what they're to do with the crops this land will produce. And there's no trick here. So question, who is giving these people this land? God, right? It's from God. They don't even have it yet. He's giving it to them. This is a gift from God to them. And from which harvest and cutting are they to bring God's portion to the priest from? The first, right? So bring to God the first. This is a big deal throughout the Bible, giving God first, not if we have anything left over, the crumbs at the end, if there's even any there. We give to God first from the first fruits. Then a little later on in Leviticus, we get an even clearer and more specific set of instructions. So in Leviticus 27, listen to this. It says, 1/10 of the produce of the land, whether grain from the fields or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord and must be set apart as holy. How much? 1/10. 10% of what? Of everything. Of grain, of fruit, of livestock. 10% of your time, your talent, your treasure. Now, some people are like, well, I don't know, that's kind of Old Testament. Well, if you want to go there, here's the deal. In the Old Testament, it really wasn't 10%. It was 23 1/3%. People were required to give 10% of everything to the priests and the Levites, 10% of everything to the functioning of the temple, and then 10% every 3 years for the feasts and the festivals that God's people would have. So it was 23 1/3% every year. The idea is it belongs to God, right? So if it belongs to God, we've got to set it apart for him. Watch how this builds in the passage. It says this, if you want to buy back the Lord's tenth, right? So, hey, I gave God his tenth, but I really want that, I need that, whatever, of the grain or the fruit, you must pay its value plus 20%. Does anyone's like, what? That was just mine. I just gave it. I want it or need it back, and now I'm getting upcharged. That doesn't seem right. Count off every tenth animal, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, from your herds and flocks, and set them apart for the Lord as holy. So God's portion is so serious and valuable. If you want to need it, if you want it back, need it back. It's going to cost you its value plus 20%. We also see here how the animals were to be given to God. And it gets more interesting. So watch this. This is awesome. Some of us, we haven't even ever read this or thought about this, but it's very informative. It says this, you may not pick and choose between good and bad animals. And you may not substitute one for the other. The idea here is this, do not mess with stuff that belongs to God. Don't do it. Knock it off, right? So if you're counting along, right, I would be terrible at this. Like, it's good for me to read this because this is a check in my spirit because I would totally do this, right? So it's like if you're counting off like 1, 2, 3, you're starting to get down the list and you're kind of eyeballing in your mind like which one's 10 and you're like, oh my gosh, number 10 is like the most glorious animal in the history of animals. Like, right? And you're like, I really want that animal. I love that animal. I want that to be mine. And but 9 is kind of a dud. So you're like, 7, 8, 9, 10, right? It's like, would anyone else do that, right? Like, it's like, and it's, we're here, like, don't do that. So here's what you think. Well, God wouldn't mind, right? Like, if 10's awesome and 9's a dud, it's like, I might be a farmer, so, or my family might require that, so I'm going to keep the good one, and then, you know, it's just God, so I'm just going to give him the dud, right? That's okay, isn't it? Well, let's see. God doesn't mind, sure. It says this, but if you do exchange one animal for the other, then both the original animal and its substitute will be considered holy and cannot be bought back. So if you want to play little games with God, right, like I'm going to do that, right, then God says that both are his. the one that was supposed to be his in the first place, and the other one as well. They both belong to him, and even if you need it or want it back, neither can be purchased back, even at that 20% premium. We've talked about this the last 2 weeks, right? The economic cycle where we plant, we grow, we harvest, we plant, we grow, we harvest. And in order for everything to work, we've got to work, right? The cycle's got to continue and go on and on. Now, for most of us today, we don't call, in our cycle, we don't call it harvest. What do we call it? We call it paycheck, right? When we harvest, whether that's weekly or every couple weeks or once a month or whatever it is for you, we call that harvest. So anytime there's a harvest or a paycheck, the idea here is the first tenth belongs to God. And when we withhold it, we are stealing. The text is telling us if we are economic theists, if we believe there's a God over this, we should give to God what is already His. Here we go. You guys fired up? Ready? Ready? More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. Because for most of us, we actually don't believe that God owns it, that it's God's. We might say that, but we don't really think that. We certainly don't live like that. We think, after all, I'm the one who showed up at that place. I'm the one who did the work. The paycheck had my name on it. And so my second answer to the question of why I tithe helps more directly with this issue. So I tithe because the tithe belongs to God. And I just want to go straight to the text on this one. Malachi chapter 3, verses 7 through 10 says this. Ever since the days of your ancestors, you have scorned my decrees and failed to obey them. Now return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of, watch, this recurs, the Lord of heaven's armies. Now notice that scorning God's decrees and failing to obey them is equated with departing from or leaving God. The idea here is if we're not living how our God asks us to, he's not our God. You can have a friend, if you talk to your friend about, what do you think I should do? Should I do this or should I do that? And your friend says, oh, you should definitely do this, and we do that. That friend can still be a friend, right? Because we're under no obligation to actually follow our friend's instruction. But if it is our God, by definition, when our God tells us to do something, we're sort of on the hook for that one, right? And if we don't do what our God says, there's more serious consequences. So watch how the text continues. But you ask, how can we return when we've never gone away? And God responds, should people cheat God? Yet you have cheated me. But we ask, what do you mean? When did we ever cheat you? The response, you have cheated me out of the tithes and offerings due me. How has God been cheated? How has God been robbed? Of his first? Of his tenth? Of what is due him? But Rob, God is so super duper loving, right? So if I just say, oh, I'm really sorry, I should have done a little better, he just kind of wipes the slate clean and we have a fresh start, right? That's how that works, right? Well, let's see. Here's how it continues. The text says, you are under a curse. We just keep going the wrong direction here, don't we? Like we should find a different passage to read from that's a little more encouraging in this area, right? For you are under a curse for your whole nation, right? This isn't just me or you or just a few of us. Like everybody, your whole nation has been cheating me. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there will be enough food in my temple. So God just wiped, no. He says, you're cursed, for we are cheating him as a whole people, and we're commanded to bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so there will be food. You know what? One of the most difficult things for me, just in general, is when people, you know, when someone needs help and even asks for help, and we don't have any food in the temple to help. And then other people go, well, come on, aren't we the church? Why aren't we supposed to help? What are we supposed to help with if there's nothing to help? Come on, right? Like, where does that, it doesn't come magically from the walls. Trust me, I've broken into some to look, right? It's not there. It doesn't work that way. Then talk about a unique move for God. He never does this. And so check out how this passage ends. If you do, says the Lord of Heaven's armies. Again, we see that term of Lord of Heaven's armies. He says, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great, you won't have enough room to take it in. And then he says this, try it. Put me to the test. In every other area of life, what do we see in the Bible? Do not put the Lord your God to the test. But when it comes to this area, we're commanded to actually test him. The difference between God's people having everything taken from them versus being the envy of every other nation was simply in whether they were faithful to give God what was his. And God says, put me to the test. Don't miss that term, the Lord of Heaven's armies, right? The ideas here are that God provides. God, it's God's pie, right? He provides. He does not need what you have and what I have. He doesn't need it. But because he commands the armies of heaven, if he so chooses, he can take it. And so you and I, we should volunteer what we're holding on to, recognizing it isn't ours anyway. Now, some of you are like, Rob, I notice what you're doing here. You're spending all this time in the Old Testament. That is Old Testament law. We live under New Testament love. Can I just tell you, there's nothing more clear to me than love actually demands more than law ever did. Right? Because here's the thing. You're like, well, does God want me to give 10%? Does God want me to give 23 1/3%? What does God model for us? What does God give to us in the New Testament? How, what percent? 100%, right? And what does he ask in return? He asks for our whole lives, 100% of us. And a tithe is literally the smallest first rung thing we can find anywhere in the scripture as a representation that we are giving our whole lives to him. And if we won't even give that, can we really say we're giving our lives to him? I mean, it's a good question, right? Something for us to answer. Now, let me put this in a more practical term. Anyone parent in here? Or have you ever traveled with kids? One of the worst things to ever do in the history of the world is travel with children, right? Jim and Laura, I'm sorry, you guys are gonna learn this in the not too distant future. It's like, it's everything about parenting is awesome except traveling with kids. It's horrific. If you travel with kids, you know, anytime you have to stop anywhere, it's like, hey, can we get this? Can we get this? Can we get that? We need that, right? Like, you know, am I speaking anyone's language here? You know what I'm talking about? And then it doesn't matter if we are driving like the 2.5 minutes from here to our house. If we have to stop at the gas station, both of my children instantly need 87 things. Can we get chips? Can we get cheese? Can we get a drink? Can we get snacks? Can we, right? Right? And so maybe one time you're going in and they're like, hey, can you get Skittles? Right? Have you ever had them? I don't know what your thing is, Reese's Pieces, Skittles, doesn't matter, right? Dad, can we get some Skittles? Right? And of course, I actually try to be mean at first, like, I'm not getting you guys. And then I go in and I buy like half the store. And it's crazy, right? Because if you buy stuff at a gas station, it's literally the most expensive place to buy things on the planet, right? And so you end up spending $1 million in the gas station on junk food. But of course, like the Bible says this, right? Like, though you are evil, you know how to give your children good gifts. How much more does our Father in heaven want to give us as his kids good gift? Because he's perfect. Right? And so of course I come out with their favorite drinks and snacks and whatever they want. So let's just think, maybe your kid's thing is Skittles, right? So all of a sudden you come out, they wanted Skittles, you got them some Skittles, and this is a typical move, right? You hop back in the vehicle and sometimes you just pitch it back there, but a lot of times what do? We go like this, right? Right? Because what are we doing? It's dad tax. Right? Now I know if you're a mom tax is the same, right? It's the same. And what do we want? We don't want like the whole package. We don't want half the package. We don't even want we just want a few, right? And then we're gonna hand the whole rest. After we have a few, we're going to hand the whole rest to our kid and give them the whole thing. Now, Christopher, you should share those because we're talking about being generous. But come on, this is one of those things that for all of us is challenging, right? Because if you've ever traveled with kids, if this has ever happened, like what happens when we have done this and we want just a few and we're going to give the, what happens? Dad! Right? And then, at least for me, maybe not for you, but for me, I start to like lose it. Like, what? Right? Dad, those are mine. What? I went in, I bought those with my money, I brought them out here, and out of the goodness of my heart, I'm taking what is mine, and I'm giving almost all of it to you. And you have the audacity to question me in this and to tell me that this is, like, what am I doing and that that's yours? Right? Like, and I don't care if you don't have enough money, right? Or you don't have much money. All of us have enough money where we could buy enough Skittles, where we could fill up a whole bathtub and literally bathe in them if we wanted to. And when my kids pull that bull crap on me, what I want to do is I want to say, listen, I brought you into this world and I can take you out of it. It's Liam, yeah. Yeah. So here's the thing. Let's do it again. Can we do it again? More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. See, don't we behave like those same spoiled little brat kids when it comes down to what we think is our stuff? Right? When really God owns everything we've ever had. He owns everything we currently have and everything we will have. It's God's. So when you leave today, we're going to give every one of you, and if you have kids, grab one for them too. We're going to give every one of you a little mini Skittles pack as a reminder of this idea, right? Don't do this. And you're like, if you're here and you're like, oh, I'm not really a sugar person, I don't eat sugar. Perfect. Then instead of eating these, tape them up like on your mirror or on your fridge or somewhere as a reminder that God gives us the whole thing and he just asks for a little bit in return. Or tape up your empty package as the case may be. So the third reason I tithe is because, this is a big one, I want God's favor on my life. Anybody else want God's favor? Right? Proverbs 3, 5 through 10 says this, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Now, that's the cute part of the verse that winds up on our mugs and on our paintings, right? But the rest of the passage colors this even more. Watch this. Don't be impressed with your own wisdom. Ooh. Anyone else ever a little bit too impressed with their own wisdom sometimes? Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Then you will have healing for your body and strength for your bones. Here's the deal, church. The blessing you want and need doesn't and can't come from you. Do you get that? The blessing you want, the blessing that we all need, it doesn't come from us. It doesn't come from our wisdom. It only comes from him. And then we get really practical. Watch this. This is so good. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you produce. Then he will fill your barns with grain. And here you go, ladies. And your vats will overflow with good wine. Come on. Give God the first. Give God the best. And give God the tenth. And he will bless you. I want him to bless me. I don't know about you, I do. Now, here's the thing though. It's like, okay, so there's the rule. If I do that, then I get good. No, you cannot buy God's favor. You can't buy it. There's no price on God's favor. But you can obey for it, right? It's not about what we buy, it's about our obedience. And so I want us to think there's a couple different approaches here. The first is what I would call atheist economics. How does somebody who doesn't believe in God or denies God handle money? And I have some boxes up here that I want to talk about. So an atheist, they start with fun, right? I get my paycheck, I do what I want, right? Anyone know what that's like? Come on, right? Here's the problem when we do it that way. If you jump into fun first, has anyone else ever done that and you feel like stress and guilt like the whole time because you're like, I got a whole bunch of other things I got to do and I'm starting off by wasting money on fun stuff that really doesn't, right? Everybody's working for the, right? Like, come on, right? That's what we do. Or this, have you ever gone on vacation and the whole time you're stressed out because you spent money you didn't have and now you're in a deep hole? And you're like, how long is it going to, right? We start with fun and it's so hard. And then we get sort of through the fun, recover the next morning, and then we're like, okay, now I got to take care of my needs. I got to pay my mortgage. I got to pay for my car, put gas, whatever that is, right? And then we move to debt, right? It's like, oh, I'm in the hole in a whole bunch of different ways, and I've only gone further because I did too much fun stuff, right? We move to debt. And then if there's anything left over after those first three, and it doesn't seem like there usually is, then we save a little bit, hopefully, right? And then, in the end, if there's any left over, it's like those few little crumbs, and we're like, well, I'll give, or I'll share, I'll do something, or think about someone else. That is the typical way someone who is an atheist treats money. How are we, as theists, people who believe there is a God over us in our lives, in our finances, how does a theist treat money? Well, here we go. So the first box is give, and we've seen this already, right? This idea of first fruits. We give God the first, the best, right? The tithe, the tenth. So we start with that. And then, this is crazy, right? Some of you are like, that's crazy. I don't think that'll even work. We save. Have you ever heard that? Like the number one way to become a millionaire is to pay God and to pay us, right? We give, we save. If you always start with those, you're gonna be miles ahead. The middle one stays the same. We do debt next. And the reason we do debt, if you've been through FPU or talked to anyone who's been through FPU, you've learned this, right? Our number one way to have resources is our income. And the more of our income we spend on bad past decisions, the less of our income we actually can use for what we want and are supposed to use it for, right? So we want to attack debt like crazy so that we can do other things. And then the next one, I know this sounds crazy, is needs, because most of us needs are way down there, right? Like, oh, I got to do these things. Then we do needs. And then the last one, this is so good. It's fun, but it's fun with favor, right? Because it's guilt-free. It's sort of like, I know this is not fun, but one of the things I always hated was grocery shopping, not because I don't like grocery shopping, but because I hate buying something that you've got to buy again and again and again and again forever till you die. I just don't, you know, like, and it's like every 4 days. What do you mean we got to go spend another $150? We just spent, you know what I mean? Like, anyone with me on this? One of the things that was so helpful for us was actually budgeting. So here's the dollar amount, right? We're going to spend that every week. Here's what we're going to spend a month. You can spend it all in week one or all in week three or a little bit here and there or evenly distribute it. It doesn't matter. And it's like, right? It's fun with favor. It's stress free. And I know for some of you, you're like, that would never work. I'm going to show you something next week that is just the perfect illustration for how this actually always works. If you give to God first, you will always have it. If you make God last, you will never have it. And some of you are like, well, when you put it like that, it sounds so simple. So why do so many people struggle with this? Because again, let's do it, ready? More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. See, we want God's favor, but we want it on sale at the lowest possible price. We say, Jesus, I know my salvation cost you everything, but you're God and I'm on a tight budget, right? So I don't think I can really do that. Ugh. Aren't we terrible? We're kind of terrible sometimes, aren't we? I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about all of us. All right. Here's the final reason. final reason I tithe is because I want treasure in heaven. The Bible is simple and clear here too. Matthew 6, 19 through 21 says this: "Don't store up treasures here on earth, where moths eat them and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store up your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also." When it comes to participation, when it comes to being generous or giving, we all have good reasons sometimes not to participate. Man, there was this health thing that happened, or we had a family emergency and had to redirect some resources. But the stuff that typically keeps us away from contributing is usually frightening, and especially because when we think about it, it keeps us from changing the world for eternity. When we're off spending our money on sports and hunting, and this one hits too close to homes, I should have scratched this out, but building projects, right? Remodels. Here, another good one is this, right? Christmas. It's like when we celebrate Jesus' birthday and we don't want to like be generous because we're too busy buying crap for us and others to be generous and participate in Jesus' mission on Jesus' birthday. Like, crazy, right? It's crazy. We're terrible. We just are. All right, so one more time. Ready? This is it. Last time. So let's do this one good, okay? Beat First Gathering. Beat First. More than a faithfulness problem, we have an ownership problem. Okay, so I want to, in one final attempt at the end of this teaching, I want to try to help you solve the ownership problem once and for all. And I want to help inspire faithful obedience. I'm going to actually create a little pathway. Now, I want to say this because when we did this 6 years ago, an enterprising young man short-circuited my system. And so if you were here in the first gathering or someone told you about this from the first gathering, please do not participate. Good? Good. All right. So I have something for the first person to come up to the stage with $10. It's got to be, I don't have change. It's got to be 10 bucks. The first person up here beside me with $10, I have something for you. All right, look at that. Man. All right, now come on over here. Come over here. And I'm not even going to, you can put it right here on the edge. That's 10 bucks. Yep. Okay, there we go. I'm going to leave it there. Now, I get it, right? It's been a longer message. You're like, nah, it's about normal. It's been a longer message. There's people out here looking at you, right? So it's like a little, I don't want you to feel any pressure. Okay, so if what the offer I'm going to make, like, don't feel suckered into this or, you know, whatever. If the deal I make you is a bad deal, you are welcome to take your 10 bucks and go sit back down. Okay, so zero pressure. All right, so if you will give me that, I will give you this. Deal? What is this?
100 bucks.
A hundo? All right, so here you go. That's you. This is me. Good? Sweet. Thank you. No, that's you. No trick. All right? All right. So hang on. Is that pretty sweet? Right? Yeah. Some of you were like, oh, I can't. You were like nudging your spouse like, I told you to look in your wallet faster. Right? So here's the thing. Hold yours up. I'm going to hold mine up too, right? So This is what God does. This is when we get this ownership thing sorted out in our minds. This is actually what God does. God says, I'm going to give you this, and all I want in return is this. Right? Because it came from him. It was his in the first place. He's like, I'll give you that. You give me this. Good deal, right? Awesome. Hey, thank you. Nice. So here's the deal. Honor God with your first fruits, because robbing is for economic atheists. Give God the first. Give God the best. give God the tenth. Don't rob God, because in the end, that doesn't hurt God. It hurts us. We are the ones who suffer. So a question. Have you been an economic atheist? And maybe a more important or a more relevant question, because here's the truth. We can't do anything to change what we have done or who we have been. Are you going to be an economic atheist going forward? Or are you going to do something different? And I know, like, it's really easy sometimes for you to think things like, well, that's easy for you to say. It's really not. It's not easy for me to say. In fact, the last 6, 7, 8 months, the better part of the last year, has literally been the most difficult season that I can remember. It's been a long, long time for us to be generous, for us to give. And it started this summer when we decided we were going to buy a house, a different house. We're going to sell our house and buy a house. And then the bank said, you have to have, you know, $40,000 to close. And a bunch of that came from the sale of our old house, but we had to get a bunch. So we were like selling things and, you know, praying for money to fall from the sky and things like that. And then when we moved in, we started this remodel, and nobody ever tells you how much every single thing costs for a house. Do I have any ameners in here? Right? It's like there's no such thing as a cheap house project on any level, even if you're using cheaper materials. It's just not the case. And so we had enough money for the kitchen, but we paid it in 3 installments. So when we knew, okay, I have to scratch some checks with a lot of zeros, even though we have this, like I need to make sure on that date there's that much money in our checking account. So instead of doing what we always do when we get paid, and then give to God, we get paid and give to God, like that's what we do. But it was like, well, I got to make sure I have $4,000 or $5,000 or $6,000 to write a check in my bank account. It's like, I got to make sure that that's there, and then we'll catch up. So we got out of that habit a little bit. And so as we were getting to the end of January and the last of our kitchen was paid for, I sat down one day at the end of January to kind of pay bills. And when I started it, have you ever done this where you like look at your account balance and you're like, hey, how is there that much money in there? And then you pay bills and you're like, ah, right? Come on, anybody else? Right? It's like horrifically frightening what happens in those 30 minutes. So I'm like, I paid our mortgage. I was actually a little bit behind. I was warned maybe I shouldn't say this, so I probably shouldn't say this, but I got a little behind too on our numerous compassion kids. And I'm like, I think they still get the rice and beans, but like it's like I can't not, like I gotta, you know, like we caught. So I'm catching things up, and then I get to the on my list the tithe. And it had been a while because I had to make sure I had enough money in my account for those larger checks. So I start doing the math. And the number that came up for our tithe was $900. $900. I had enough to pay for the kitchen, but you know, with the roof and floor and this, that, and the next thing and appliances, it's like I'm looking at our debt. You know, I'm looking at the $46,000 in debt from the remodel. And I'm looking at 900 bucks that could go a long way to help knock that down even more, right? And then even as a pastor, can I just be honest? As a pastor, right, I'm looking at that number and I'm like, I could give 600 and nobody'd ever question me. And that still looks like a big number, right? 600 bucks is 600 bucks. What do I do? And you know what? I logged in and I started that number with a 9. Put the appropriate amount of zeros with it and push the button. I just want you to hear this, church. God is faithful. God is good. We can trust him. Listen, I know, like for people like, oh, I don't like when they talk about money, or it's been 6 years since we've done a series on money. We don't really talk about money. And when we do, I'm not talking to you about money. It's me too. right? What God says applies to my life just like yours. And don't mishear me. This series, this conversation has nothing to do with our plan to fund the budget. Like, hopefully they'll feel bad, they'll give a little more, we'll hit budget more consistently. No, no, no. This has everything to do with God's plan to change the world. That's what us being generous and consistent and faithful is all about. That's what the invitation is. And so God, today, I just want to pray that maybe some of my reasons, some of my answers to the question why I tithe, why my family tries to be generous. God, I pray that these would be helpful. I pray that these things would be inspiring. God, may we as a people live our lives more on Sunday and every single day of the week in a way that reflects what we say we believe and reflects who we believe. God, may our lives more and more cause heaven to crash into earth in ways that change things, both now and forever. And God, this isn't all about guilt. Set us free from any feelings of guilt from what we have done, what we are doing. And God, I just ask in the name of Jesus that you would bless us and use us now. How we live and how we give. God, use us to change the world. We ask together in Jesus' name. Amen.